When I was talking to Dr. Bhandari, I suggested that we should now,
चलो
our Indian data should come forward so that we should know what is the outcome of our own cases, what we are doing, and where do we stand. Keeping that in mind, this session has been planned to discuss the outcome analysis of the robotic radical prostatectomy. There will be three presentations. First will be by Dr. Jagdish Kulkarni, where he is going to compare his open radical prostatectomy versus robotic radical prostatectomy experience. Dr. Dogra, this is the largest and longest series, so he is going to talk about the AIMS experience, and myself, I'll give the experience at Medanta.
First 10 minutes I'll spend on open, you know, data which we published in 2011 with a 7-year follow-up. The program of open radical prostatectomy started back in 1996 till 2000. Now this is the complete analysis. Now from 1996 to 2011, we've done about 670 open radical prostatectomies, of which, of course, 428 were evaluable, minimum follow-up being at least 3 months to maximum about 15 years. This was the age range. You can see there were enough number of patients above the 70 also. There were two patients above the age of 80 as well. Biologically, they did look less than 80, that's why we did it. Clinical staging, as in the beginning Dr. Ganpule said, and we also had in the early part of the study, the patients were beyond the organ of the origin, so T3 disease we did. Gleason score, that time we used to use less than 4, now no more, now this is clubbed as of 6, 7, 8 and 10. Good number of patients had a Gleason score of 8 and 10 as well, because this is what our analysis was. Now look at this blood loss. You can see initial part over 2 liters, but minimum blood loss was 300 cc's, minimum. I mean, I can't have a patient who had less than 100 cc or something. A couple of cases here and there, maybe, but minimum was about 300 open surgery. Complications, 45 patients out of 420 had some form of complications, urinoma, leak, retention, several complications, which is a standard happening in the open procedures when you have a series which is going on for 15 years. Late complications, bladder neck contractures 2.3, urethral strictures, lymphoseal, inguinal hernia also. These are the patients had. Honestly speaking, nerve sparing procedures were done only in 45 patients because there were no patients who were coming below the age of 4. So that is the problem. And of those 45, actually potency could be possible only in 59%. So honest, confessing that nerve sparing was not possible and in whom they possible, we couldn't get the best out of them. Now continence, that is again a problem. 1.8% remained incontinent completely. There was a problem. But at the end, we had only 64% continence. Meaning we used to have some kind of pad or something, not totally incontinent. So essentially about 60 to 75% would be the patient who will not require anything. Margin status, you can see here superior margins, inferior margins were more common, and both margins in 23 patients. This is the data. Now when you look at this, you can see negative margins were 118 only, 80% patients. These are the patients who had a prior TURP, because that is a significant number of patients in the first, even now and today, I'm sure Dr. Gupta will agree, that we do get patients who had a post-TURP. Diagnosis done by TURP and then sent to us for further management. So essentially margins did remain a problem. Histology, Gleason score, maybe this, I don't know whether you can see this, but 8 to 10. Now, let's look at this, 5 and 6, biopsy Gleason score. And you can see only 46% was really correlating. In the sense, you have a biopsy Gleason for 5 to 6, turned out to be pathologically 5 to 6, remaining either were higher or more higher. Now, as I said, follow-up was 36 months, in fact. Median follow-up was 84 months. Now, let's look at this graph, which clearly says that if the PT0, there are some patients, P0 PT0 means there was actually what we had a biopsy done, but no tumor found on the specimen. So PT0, remaining patient. But as the stage increased, the survival. But at 7 years, it's not bad. Even if a bad disease, not bad. It can be managed. Biopsy Gleason score, same thing as I said. Again, look at this. At 7 years, all the Gleason's or high disease was not really all the loss, all these lost. Clinical staging, there were some inadequacies in clinical staging. Again, confirms the fact that low volume disease, better survival. PSA, in the first 5 years, we didn't have PSA as a routine. After 2002, the PSA became routine. So although this is a little vicious data, but I think it does say that higher the PSA, less the survival. Now lymph node status, look at this. 78% positive lymph nodes, NED 51%, alive with disease. So these alive with disease don't die immediately. They can still continue. So it is here that we can help them, so they'll go on. You may have ultimately death, only 42% died in our case. But these 6-5, so about 56 to 60% were, majority were alive without disease, but some were alive with the disease. So all is not lost if there is a disease recurrence. So what are the conclusions? Our conclusion, 1/3 patients had a previous TURP, that data. PSA more than 10, in significant number of patients. So if I had to put a criteria that about 10, I will not do, I will never be doing prostatectomy. Biopsy Gleason score correlation to the pathology was only in higher 7 and 8 and not in 6. Clinical stage correlate well with pathological higher stage. High risk group, lymph node positive, had a poor survival. Cutoffs of PSA, we still are evolving. I do not know what is the cutoff level now also. Now this is as far as the open surgery is concerned. Now let's look at this. Of course, I don't have a pathological finder, but let me talk to only in morbidity. Now this is 188, evaluable 155, 64 to 82 years, as I said. PSA 12. Luckily, we are starting getting now less PSA. T2C, we have also T3-1. Now minimum blood loss, as I showed you there, the blood loss at the end, even I came to about 300, so this is definitely less. Here I was new. From open, I started converted into robotic surgery, I was new. Then when I had a 10 years plus experience, still blood loss was high. Here it is less. Mean operative time, I think that is all right. Blood transfusions, we have not given any blood transfusions. Late complications, of course, these are all the things which is very standard. 11 patient has initial stress incontinence. Now you can see the drop in hemoglobin only 1.3 grams, right from our, you know, learning curve. So what is the message for me? That in the early data, it shows blood loss is less, better recovery, morbidity is less, and most important thing is, then I was less than 50, I am 60 now. Then I was doing a large procedure, I used to feel tired. After 60, doing this radical prostatectomy, I'm not tired. In fact, my wife said, after the robot has come, you're looking more fresh after a major surgery of this magnitude. So the story is, not only it reduces patient's morbidity, but also reduces a surgeon's morbidity and adds 10 more years of life. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jagdish.